Amistad and Harper Audio present The Essential Dick Gregory by Dick Gregory, read by Joe Morton with Christian Gregory, Andre Gaines, and Afrika K. Kenjyatta.
A note before we begin. For credits, acknowledgments, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to harpercollins.com/pages/The Essential Dick Gregory. To Lil.
Foreword. Separated by almost exactly one century, two significant events were responsible for capturing the minds of Americans and creating the man we would all come to know as the one and only Dick Gregory. The first was the raid on Harper's Ferry by famed abolitionist John Brown in October 1859, which was often called the dress rehearsal or tragic prelude to the American Civil War. The second was the publishing of a remarkable article in Ebony magazine in October 1960 entitled "Why Negro Comics Don't Make It Big," in which Dick Gregory was mentioned for the first time on the national stage as a mere newcomer. To most historians, comedians, and students of the black experience in America, these events appear to represent two fundamentally unrelated circumstances in the shaping of our country as we know it. However, every year, on Dick Gregory's birthday, a date which almost perfectly aligns with John Brown's October raid, Dick Gregory would visit Harper's Ferry in memoriam. On every 2nd of December, he would go to Charlestown, Virginia, now in West Virginia, and hug the tree where John Brown was hanged. "I hug the tree for the white man who gave up his life for the black man," he said. "There are trees all over the world. Lots of other places have trees. What they do not have that this tree has is the spirit of John Brown." Without the historic raid on Harper's Ferry, without the death of John Brown and the end of the enslavement of black people in America, we might not have ever heard the name Dick Gregory or seen it introduced to the world in that ebony article one century later. Everyone knows that the 1960s were a tumultuous time in our nation's history, but few people know that even comedy itself was segregated between blacks and whites. In that same ebony article, one white club owner would say, "I am very apprehensive about booking Negroes into my club. I don't want a Negro comedian entertaining whites at the expense of Negro people." The famed television star Steve Allen even more poignantly stated, "One reason that there is a shortage of Negro stand-up comedians or humorists is that comedy of this sort usually involves a certain amount of critical observation, and our society is probably not civilized enough yet to permit or encourage the Negro comedian to make satirical commentary about Eisenhower's golf game, our bungled international relations, the Un-American Activities Committee, or other things of that sort." Steve Allen would go on to conclude, "Just imagine a Negro comic getting up on stage and saying some of the things that Lenny Bruce or Mort Saul are getting away with." Barely 3 months after the publication of this story, Dick Gregory, the so-called newcomer, would prove Steve Allen wrong, or right, depending on your point of view, and wrap all the prejudicial conjecture, race theory, and misfired predictions of critics and TV stars into the palm of his hand, then take the mic on the biggest stage possible in those days, the Jack Parr Show on NBC. At the outset of my 6-year journey to bring the incredible life story of Dick Gregory to film, I was vastly unaware of the immense complexity behind Dick Gregory's brand of humor. Throughout his life, Dick Gregory was often made an example of, sometimes by his own design. Black folks projected our woes onto him, and white folks cherished or reviled him for shining a mirror on their own prejudice. For me, the personal experiences of Dick Gregory were like listening to a walking history lesson. It took only a few hours into my journey to make this film for me to realize that Dick Gregory was one of a kind, and I became totally consumed. In 1975, Dick Gregory quit comedy, staging his last nightclub performance at Paul's Mall in Boston, Massachusetts. The announcer who introduced Dick Gregory read a letter from his publicist, Steve Jaffe, that highlighted the power of his contributions to society. One passage went like this: "No man has given more, ask less, or been more needed. Albeit only a brief summation of the gifts of Dick Gregory, I can think of no more prescient a phrase to describe what he would come to mean to the world. Dick Gregory is often credited as being a civil rights activist, and although it may have started that way, civil rights, like comedy, was never his terminus. Yes, he was an activist, but more appropriately, he was an advocate and protector of human rights. Thus, when the time came to create a graphic for the poster to represent the film, none was more fitting than that of Dick Gregory, sitting center stage, illuminated by infinite silhouettes of himself in the different colors of the rainbow. The array of colors represents to me not only the many lives that Dick Gregory lived, but also his aura. While he walked the earth as a black man, talked and thought as a black man, he could feel like every man, and his spirit, heart, and empathy toward all mankind are what made him the great teacher, guru, advisor, and friend he became to me and the world. When you combine all of those colors together, it produces the white light as projected by the sun, and no one better understood the power of the sun or how to use it as a force of good and righteousness than Dick Gregory. Andre Gaines, producer and director, the one and only Dick Gregory.
Letter from the editor. What a life. What a blessing. Dick Gregory was many things. He metamorphosed from athlete to comedian to activist to presidential candidate to nutritionist to social critic. At no point leaving behind the nucleus holding him together. Love. Love. Love for self. Love for thy neighbor. Love for humankind. Love for nature was the engine that powered his many manifestations. Metamorphosis is a change of the form or nature of a thing or person into a completely different one by natural or supernatural means. It's typically brought about by both internal and external forces. The sum of these forces produces a new manifestation that advances its previous form. At every iteration, Dick Gregory was passionate about life, laughter, and equality. There was not a righteous movement in his lifetime that his blood, sweat, or tears didn't impact. His activism was rooted in love and dignity. Richard Claxton Gregory's life was incredibly well-lived. My colleagues and I studied his mind like the science it often was. We've extrapolated from his lifetime the building blocks and experiences that help explain his unyielding life of service. Generations will delve into his sacrifice, comedic genius, focus, and aptitude. Civil rights, women's rights, children's rights, human rights, disabled rights, animal rights. Dick Gregory's DNA is on virtually every movement for fairness and equality for all living things on this planet. He taught us the power of love by example. Dick Gregory was always busy, but never hurried. He made time for everyone and almost everything. He wrote a lot, but talked more. He left us so much to pore over, including 16 books, 12 albums, hundreds of interviews and syndicated news columns, and hundreds of hours of archival footage. The challenge we faced was whittling down this extraordinary amount of material to present it in a succinct structure. We were able to organize this book into three primary sections: the body, covering his early life from 1932 through 1960, the mind, discourse related to his early career from 1961 to 1970, and the spirit, later career thoughts and work from 1971 to 2017, to highlight the periods in his life where his aptitude and brilliance evolved. With the exception of the headnotes, which provide orientation and historical positioning, everything was written or said by Dick Gregory in his own unique style, tempo, and cadence. The highlights of Dick Gregory's life are well known. However, the ebbs and flows were lost in the brightness of the peaks. More often than not, the real lessons are in the journey. I'm delighted to have you take this journey with us. I trust you'll be as uplifted and inspired as we were cultivating and compiling this collection. Loving and Lovable, Christian Claxton Gregory. Part 1. The Body, 1932 to 1960. On October 12, 1932, State File Number 124-32-045154 was issued to one Richard Claxton Gregory, the second son of Mother Lucille Franklin, 28, of Missouri, and Father Presley Gregory, 34, of Tennessee. The first decade of life was about to be profoundly difficult for Richard, who had experienced the Great Depression and Jim Crow. The skinniest kid on the block in the Ville would also be the poorest. Black Tuesday's thick black smoke from coal-burning emissions would turn 7-year-old Richard's days into the darkest of nights. Lurking in all that darkness was a spirit so full of promise that a psychic acknowledged a star on his head. Stars are not born, they are formed. A perfect combination of nature and nurture. Pressure and heat make steel. Sustained pressure on coal yields diamonds. This diamond in the rough would go on to shine so brightly that he would be a light bearer, using his light to leave the world better than he found it. Christian Gregory.
1803, North Taylor. All ramps, no stairs. I was malnourished. As a matter of fact, I was so small that they sent me to a special school in St. Louis called Turner Open Air School. This was where disabled kids went, or kids that had polio, or were handicapped, kids with one leg, or with one arm, or with very bad eyes, or who were underweight. I guess I went there for a year, or maybe a little bit longer. Kids used to harass me a lot because to go to that school meant something was wrong with you. I was very young. I guess I was 7 or 8. The school district authorities would just come like the dog catchers and pick you up out of public school, just barely short of the hook and the net, catch you and grab you and put you in there. But I dug in school myself. I mean, people used to put it down and say there was something wrong with me and this and that, but we were the few kids that had a bus come by to pick me and my brother up every morning. We got on that bus, went to school, ate, and had a rest period with real clean beds. You brushed your teeth there, you combed your hair. I learned a lot from that school. Got food and filtered air. I don't know anybody else in public school in America that had filtered air. Maybe this is the reason that my lungs developed so strong was from the filtered air and eventually led me to being a great trackman. I don't know what the reason was, but we left and went back to public school. There was one time I think I stayed out of public school for 3 months or 6 months when my feet were frostbitten when I was out selling papers. Little kid, 9 or 10 years old. I came home, stuck my feet right in the oven, and they swelled up like a balloon and split right down the middle. I couldn't go to school then, and consequently I was like 15 years old before I finished grade school, and 20 years old before I finished high school.
The value of humor in his childhood.
Kids used to pick on me a lot. They would tell me I didn't have a daddy, tell me I was on relief. I used to get mad and run home. And I think that's when I first began to find out about humor. I didn't know at the time. I found out if a guy starts talking about you and the crowd starts laughing with him, then there's nothing you can do or say. And I knew some of the things I was saying were much funnier than the things they were saying about me. But I never knew why they would laugh. I laid home in bed one night and I figured it out. I haven't got him with me. I'm the skinniest kid on the block. My daddy's not home. They know I'm on relief. Can I get him with me? So I used to come out, and when I'd see him coming, I'd start talking about myself. I started making jokes about me not having no daddy, making jokes about how hard my mother worked, how poor we were. I don't remember now, but I said some pretty funny things. I mean, things like the shoes they had on fit them a little better than mine, but the shoes I had on cost more than theirs did because the white folks sent my shoes to me, and I knew I had me a good pair of shoes on. The shirt might have been a little big, but it was a good shirt. I knew the people my mother was working for would go to Africa and go hunting. So at 7 or 8 years old, I was one of the few kids in America, let alone black, that knew what bear meat tasted like because mama...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.